Yes, good morning, students. Good morning, everyone. So welcome today again for the online education for English medium organized by the Education Department of Municipal Corporation of Greater Mumbai. Right. So today we are studying for class 9th and the subject is science. And the topic is the study of sound. So today's session is session number 2, where within the chapter study of sound, we are going to be learning about the concept of reflection of sound. Okay. My name is Vishal Sudhir Chaudhary. I am from the Kurar village MPS English Secondary School. Okay. So let us first go into the concept of study of sound, right? So in this chapter, we are going to be covering the concept of sound waves, where we have already studied in the previous class, the various kinds of sound waves, right? Longitudinal wave, transverse waves, right? Then also about how do the waves require a medium for the movement, right? Then we have studied about the velocity of sound, right? Then today we are going to study about reflection of sound. And further in the future classes, we are going to study about the human ear and the various kinds of sound. That are the audible sound, infrasonic sounds, and the ultrasonic sounds. Okay, then let us first recall the concept that we have learned in the previous class. That was the definition of sound, right? So sound is what? A form of energy which creates the sensation of hearing in our ears. Okay, then we had studied the properties of sound waves, where we had understood about how sound requires a medium to travel, right? Then sound is nothing but the disturbance in the form of vibration of the particles, right? Then we had studied the type of the sound waves. The first one was your longitudinal wave, right? So in a longitudinal wave, the direction of oscillation of the particles and the direction of wave motion is parallel to each other. Then the other form of wave was a transverse wave, right? In a transverse wave, the direction of oscillation and the direction of motion of the wave are perpendicular to each other, right? After that, we had seen several characteristics of sound waves, as in like you have wavelength and frequency, amplitude, time period, pitch, loudness, right? So all of these things we had studied. Okay. Then also we had studied the concept of velocity of sound, that is the distance traveled by a sound wave per unit time, right? So it was given by the formula V is equal to nu into lambda, where V is the velocity of the sound, then nu is the frequency and lambda is the wavelength, right? Then we had also studied the various factors that affect the velocity of sound, that is like temperature, density, right? Molecular mass. Okay. So all of these concepts we had studied in the previous class, right? So today we are going to learn a new concept that is relating to the types of sound. Okay. Now there are various types of sounds depending upon the wavelength and the frequency of the sound waves that are there. Okay. So based on their frequencies and sound waves, frequencies of sound waves, and whether if they are audible to us, that means whether if they are being able to be listened, means if we are able to hear those sounds or not, these are classified, the sound waves are classified into three main types. Okay. The first of them is the audible sound, right? Then the next one is the infrasound, and the third one is the ultrasound. Now, please do remember that these waves are completely, the types of these waves are completely based on their frequency, right? So if you want to recollect what is frequency, it is a number of waves per unit time, right? The number of waves passing a given point per unit time. Okay. So let us go into detail about those types of sound waves. Okay. The first one is your audible sound. Now the audible sound waves have a frequency range from 20 hertz to 20,000 hertz, right? Now, what is this hertz? Now, hertz, HZ, hertz is a unit for measuring frequency. Okay. So, one hertz happens to be one vibration or one oscillation per second, and 20,000 hertz means 20,000 oscillations per second. Okay. So, audible sounds are the ones which we can hear or which are processed by our brains, and we can hear them and identify them. Okay. So 20 hertz means a sound wave generated by an object vibrating or oscillating 20 times in a second. So it can go all the way up to the sound generated by an object vibrating 20,000 times per second. Okay. So audible sound waves have a frequency range from 20 hertz to 20,000 hertz. Okay. Then the next type of the sound waves are called as infrasounds. Now, infrasounds have a frequency that are lower than 20 hertz, right? So these are objects which are vibrating very slow, right? Very slow means the vibration can be less than 20 times in a second. Okay, so this can be just like a pendulum of a clock, right? Or maybe someone clapping their hands, right? Or a hand which is being waved. Okay, so a waving hand does produce sound, but you cannot hear it. Why? Because it is vibrating, it is oscillating less than 20 times a second. So such kind of a sound is called as an infrasound. Now some animals like elephants can hear infrasounds. Okay, then the next is a very important kind of sound that is called as an ultrasound. Now, ultrasounds have a frequency higher than 20,000 hertz, right? Now certain types of animals like bats, then dogs, dolphins, yeah, they can hear such sounds, right? Now, to simplify these numbers, the 20,000 is a very large number, right? To simplify it, we can also refer to as kilohertz, 20 kilohertz, where 1 kilohertz equals to 1,000 hertz. So 20,000 hertz can also be represented as 20 kilohertz. Okay, let us go into detail and try to study. We will try to now study in detail about those individual types of sounds. Okay, so the first one is your audible sound, right? So the limits of hearing of the human ear are 20 hertz to 20,000 hertz. The human ear can hear sound frequencies within this range. Okay, so as I have told you previously, any object which is oscillating 20 times a second to all the way up to 20,000 times a second. Right? So sound waves generated within this range, within this frequency range, can be heard by humans. Okay, so these sounds are called as audible sounds. Humans' ears cannot hear frequencies lower than 20 hertz and higher than 20,000 hertz, that is 20 kilohertz. Okay, so whatever sounds that we are able to hear, that is the vehicles moving outside or persons talking or even the music systems going around us, all of these, they generate sound waves in the range of 20 hertz to 20,000 hertz. Okay, so any sound waves having frequencies beyond 20,000 hertz or 20 hertz cannot be heard by us humans. Okay, so these are classified as your audible sounds. Then next one are your infrasounds. So sound waves with a frequency smaller than 20 hertz are called as infrasounds. Okay, so these sounds are produced by objects that are vibrating less than 20 times per second. Okay, so that means what, they will have a frequency of less than 20 hertz. Okay, the sound produced by a pendulum and the sounds generated by the vibration of the earth's crust just before an earthquake are the examples of infrasound. Okay, now certain animals can sense these vibrations, can sense these sounds which have a frequency of less than 20 hertz. As I've mentioned before, animals like elephants or some species of dogs or some animals can sense these sounds which are less than 20 hertz. Okay, so they are called as your infrasounds. Then the next kind of sound is ultrasound. Okay, now ultrasound has lots and lots of day-to-day applications that we will talk about. But let us first define what exactly is ultrasound. Sound waves with frequency greater than 20,000 hertz, that is 20 kilohertz, are called as ultrasound. Okay, 1 kilohertz equals to 1,000 hertz. So 20,000 hertz will be 20 kilohertz. So let us again define ultrasound. Sound waves with frequency greater than 20,000 hertz are called as ultrasounds. Dogs, mouse, bats, dolphins, etc. have a special ability to hear ultrasonic sounds, and they can sense some noise which is inaudible to us humans. Means dogs, bats, and these animals, they can hear and sense these sounds which have a frequency beyond 20,000 hertz, means greater than 20,000 hertz, which us humans, we cannot listen to. Okay, so they have that special ability to hear and understand these sounds having frequencies greater than 20,000 hertz. Then children under 5 years of age and some creatures and insects can hear frequencies up to 25 kilohertz, right? Means small children, right? Having an age of less than 5 years, or maybe some certain kind of animals, certain kind of creatures, insects, they can hear frequencies up to 25,000 hertz. Right? 25 kilohertz will be 25,000 hertz. Okay, then bats, mice, dolphins, etc. can also produce ultrasounds, right? Other than hearing, they can also produce such sounds, right? Then they use these sounds for communicating with each other, right? Bats use these ultrasounds to catch prey. As you can see in the figure, bats produce these ultrasounds which travel in very straight lines, and then these ultrasounds get reflected from the insects. Okay, and then the bats can determine the position of the insects and can have and eat them as food. Okay, then ultrasounds are also used to communicate between ships which are at a distance at sea. So if there are two ships which are quite far apart at sea, the two ships can use ultrasound communication between each other, right? Because at sea, there is not going to be mobile communication or telephone landlines present there, right? So for two ships which are deep into the ocean, right, they can communicate with each other by using ultrasound. Okay, then ultrasound is also used to obtain images of the internal organs in a human body. Now, there is a medical procedure called as sonography or ultrasound, right? So, if there happens to be any problem in our abdomen or maybe something like a kidney stone, right? If a person is having pain in his abdomen, then a procedure called as an ultrasound is performed, right? So, in that case, a probe, a machine sends very high frequency sound waves greater than 20,000 hertz into the abdomen, which get reflected, right, and are observed on the screen. So they can tell if there is any stone or if there is any abnormality within that organ. Okay, then ultrasounds are also used to locate cracks and faults in metal blocks. Now, ultrasound procedures are done in maintenance of railway tracks. Right. So when railway tracks are maintained, they are regularly checked by these ultrasound machines for any cracks or faults. So the tracks can be replaced before they break off. Right. So it is a very important procedure for the safety of railways. So ultrasound procedures are very important, right, for various applications. Right. So let us once again revise the kinds of sounds that we have. Right. So the first one was your audible sound. Audible sounds have a frequency range from 20 hertz to 20,000 hertz, right, which us humans can hear. Okay, and they are called as your audible sounds. Okay. Then the next one was your infrasound. Infrasounds have a frequency of less than 20 hertz. Okay, so sound produced by objects which are oscillating very slowly, something like a pendulum or maybe the motion or vibration of the earth's crust just before an earthquake, right, they are examples of your infrasound. Then we move into your ultrasounds. Ultrasounds are sound waves with frequency greater than 20,000 hertz, right? Okay. And they can, right? Dogs, mice, bats, dolphins, etc., they have a special ability to hear through these sounds, right? And which are inaudible to us humans. We humans cannot hear and listen to these ultrasounds. Okay. Then children under 5 years of age and certain creatures and insects can hear those sound waves having a frequency of greater than or up to 25,000 hertz, right? Okay. Then bats, mice, dolphins, right? They have also a ability to produce the ultrasound, right? Which can be used for catching some prey. Okay. And also to communicate within each other. Dolphins and also some species of whales, right? They communicate with each other with the help of ultrasound clicks. Okay. Then ultrasound is also used for communication between ships at sea. Okay, as they do not have availability of mobile phone coverage, coverage, or also they cannot have landline phones. Okay, then ultrasound is also used to obtain images of internal organs in a human body and also used to locate cracks and faults in a metal block, right? So heavy machinery, industries having heavy machinery or even railway tracks, right? They are periodically checked for those cracks and faults by using an ultrasound machine. Okay, now let us move into the next concept of reflection of sound, right? Now, reflection of sound is a very important property of sound. Okay, so let us try to understand the concept of reflection of sound with a simple example. Okay, or a simple activity, right? First of all, we will have two cardboard tubes, okay, of sufficient length, right? And at the end of one end of that cardboard tube, we will place a stopwatch. Now, we will keep those cardboard tubes at an angle to each other, right, against a hard object or maybe a wall or maybe a something like a plywood. Okay, then we will try to listen or place our ears at the other end of the cardboard tube and try to listen to the ticking of the clock. If you can hear the ticking of the clock, that means what? The sound waves is passing through the cardboard tube on the left hand side, getting reflected from the hard plywood and going through the second cardboard tube into our ears. This means that the sound gets reflected, right, from the wall. Now, if we draw a perpendicular on the hard plywood, which is a normal, right, and then we can imagine that the angle made by the sound waves coming from the stopwatch, right, with the normal perpendicular, right, is the angle of incidence. And the angle made by the reflected sound wave with the normal is a R, that is a angle of reflection. According to the law of reflection, the angle of incidence I equals to angle of reflection R, right? So that means what? The sound waves, just like light waves also, can get reflected, right? So let us go through the concept. Now, like light waves, sound waves too get reflected from a solid surface or a liquid surface. Okay, sound waves also follow the laws of reflection. A smooth or a rough surface is needed for the reflection of sound. So sound can get reflected from a smooth surface or even from a rough surface, right? But light waves can get reflected only from a smooth surface. Okay, then the direction of incident sound wave and reflected sound wave make equal angles with the perpendicular to the surface. And these three all lie in the same plane. Yes, that is very important that all the three, the incident ray, the reflected ray, and the normal lie in the same plane. For example, if we want to lift up, if we can lift up the cardboard tube on the right-hand side near the ear, you will no longer be able to hear the sound, right? Means if you just slightly lift up the cardboard tube, which is near close to your ears, right, by say 5 or 10 centimeters, you will no longer be able to hear the ticking of the clock. Why? Because the reflected ray will no longer be able to pass through the tube. That means all the three, that means the incident rays, incident sound rays, the reflected sound rays, as well as the normal, they should lie in the same plane, right? This is according to the laws of reflection that we have studied in the previous chapter. Okay, now let us further understand certain concepts of reflection of sound. Okay. Yes. Okay. Now, for reflection of a sound, you need to have a surface, okay, from which the sound can reflect. Now, based upon the way in which the sound is reflected from those surfaces, the reflectors are classified into two types as good and bad reflectors of sound. Okay. So, if a surface happens to reflect the sound clearly, and if the reflected sound is able to be heard distinctly, then the reflector is said to be a good reflector. Whereas if the reflector happens to absorb the sound, then it is said to be a bad reflector, right? Let us understand this concept. How much of the incident sound gets reflected decides whether a reflector is a good reflector or a bad reflector. A hard and a flat surface is a good reflector, while clothes, paper, curtains, carpet, furniture, etc., absorb sound instead of reflecting it, hence they are bad reflectors. Now, if you can observe the animation or the image below, you can see that the incident sound waves are shown in the red color. They are getting reflected from the surface in the form of a blue waves, right? But if the surface happens to have certain gaps into it, right, the sound waves can pass through these waves and get absorbed within the surface and get transmitted behind. Okay, so some of the energy of the sound waves can be transmitted in the form of heat waves, right? So the reflected sound will be lesser than the incident sound. So in such a case, the object will be a bad reflector, right? So soft surfaces like sponge or maybe cardboard or curtains, right? They are bad reflectors. Even wood. Wood has lots of grains and lots of gaps into it, right? Hollow spaces into it. So wood happens to behave as a bad reflector, right? So in the concepts ahead that we are going to study, we are going to discuss in quite detail about good reflectors and bad reflectors of sound, okay? Because they play a very important role in how we perceive sound in and around us, okay? Then, the next concept is a very important concept, that is of an echo, okay? So when you may have visited a hill station, on almost all hill stations, you happen to have something called as a echo point. Okay, so you must have visited an echo point at a hill station, right? If you happen to go to somewhere like Mathiran or even like Mahabaleshwar, there are lots of these echo points, right? They have a very distinct characteristic and a very interesting experience we can have over there. Okay, if you shout loudly at such an echo point, you can hear the same sound just after a little while, and this sound is called as an echo. Means if you happen to stand at the edge of such an echo point and if you shout loudly, what will happen is your sound will be repeated after a certain while. Now that happens because when you shout, what happens, the sound waves traveling from you, they go across the mountain or a hill and they strike the surface of the hill on the other side. Those sound waves get reflected back and they come back to us again. So you can hear your own voice in a repeated manner again. Okay. So an echo is a repetition of the original sound because of reflection from some surface. Right. So if you happen to have a wall far away or maybe a mountain far away, and if you happen to shout out very loudly, right, you can get the repetition of the sound, which is termed as an echo. Okay. So there are certain conditions for an echo to be heard. Now, if you observe the image here, you can see that a person standing, when he shouts, the sound waves travel from him to the reflecting surface, which in this case is a wall, right? The sound gets reflected back, right? And then you can hear the echo. But echo cannot be heard in all cases. Say, for example, if you are sitting in your room and if you shout out loudly, you cannot get an echo because there are very specific conditions for us to hear an echo, right? Now, let us see what are those conditions. Okay. Now, in order to be able to hear the original sound and its reflection distinctly at a temperature that is 22 degrees Celsius, what must be the minimum distance between the source and the reflecting surface? Right, so we can calculate this distance which is required. Okay, now let us try to understand this. Okay, now if you happen to have a wall in front of us, wherever you are sitting right now in your room, if you shout out loudly, you will not get that echo or a repeated sound because of a certain concept. Right, we will talk about that. Now, sound happens to have a certain velocity in air. And if, as we have studied in the previous class, the velocity of sound depends upon the temperature. Okay, so higher the temperature, higher is the velocity of the sound. If you remember, velocity of the sound is directly proportional to square root of the temperature. Okay, fine. Let us understand this. Now, at 22 degrees Celsius, the velocity of sound in air is 344 meters per second. Right? So sound waves travel quite fast. That means they travel 344 meters per second. Okay. Now, whenever any sound enters our ears and it is registered in our brain, it stays in our brain for about 0.1 seconds. That means once you have heard the sound, our brain cannot identify the same sound for the next 0.1 seconds. If you hear it again, it cannot register that sound. Okay, that is called as the persistence of sound in our brain. Okay, so our brain retains this sound for 0.1 seconds. Thus, for us to be able to hear a distinct echo, the sound should take more than 0.1 seconds after starting from the source to get reflected and come back to us. That means once you have shouted, the sound should take more than 0.1 seconds to go up to the reflecting surface and come back. Okay, so we can very easily calculate the distance that must be required between the two surfaces, right? Let us talk about that. So we can determine the minimum distance between the source and the reflecting surface as follows, right? Now we know the formula for speed. Speed equals to distance upon time. Now we need to calculate the distance. So we rearrange the formula as distance is equal to speed multiplied by the time taken. Okay. Now, the speed of sound, we know that it is 344 meters per second. And the time, minimum time that needs to be traveled for which the sound needs to be traveling is 0.1 seconds. So 344 multiplied by 0.1 seconds, we get 34.4 meters. That means for us to hear an echo, the sound should travel a minimum distance of 34.4 meters back and forth. That means once you have shouted, the sound should travel from you up to the reflecting surface and then after reflection from the reflecting surface back to you, the total distance traveled should be 34.4 meters, right? Thus, to be able to hear a distinct echo, the reflecting surface should be at a minimum distance of half the above. That means in the forward direction, it goes from U up to the reflecting surface, that is the wall. And then after reflection from the wall, it comes back to U. That means the total distance traveled should be 34.4 meters. So if you divide 34.4 by 2, you get a distance of around 17.2 meters. Now you should remember that this distance 17.2 meters can change, and it can change with the temperature, as we have already learned that the velocity of sound in air depends on the temperature of the medium, right? So as the velocity of sound in air depends on the temperature of the air, the distance also depends on the temperature of the air. Got the point? Okay, so let us once again try to understand the concept of sound, I mean the echo, okay? So, right? So an echo is a repetition of the original sound because of reflection from some surface. Okay, so a sound needs to be reflected after traveling a certain distance. Okay, so at 22 degrees Celsius, the velocity of sound in air is 344 meters per second. And our brain retains this sound for 0.1 seconds. Okay, so for us to be able to hear a distinct echo, the sound should take more than 0.1 seconds after starting from the source to get reflected and come back to us. Okay, so we can determine the distance traveled by taking the formula distance equals to speed into time, substituting the value of the speed of sound, that is 344 meters per second, and the minimum time as 0.1, we get the distance traveled, minimum distance traveled to be 34.4 meters, right? As the sound has to travel back and forth distance, means once you have shouted from U, that is from the source of the sound to the reflecting surface and back to the source of the sound, that means you should divide the value 34.4 by 2. So the minimum distance between the source of the sound and the reflecting surface to produce an echo should be 17.2 meters, right? Now, one of the next concepts relating to the reflection of the sound is reverberation. Now, reverberation is an undesired concept. We do not need, means reflection of sound sometimes generates undesirable properties or undesirable things, which we do not want. Now, let us try to understand the concept of reverberation with the comparison between two cases, right? Let us go into the first case on the left-hand side. Go to an empty room or a closed house with your friends. So you can have 3 or 4 or 5 friends and you can go into an empty closed house where windows are closed, right? Now, once inside, you can sit down or you can sit down and start a chat with your friends, right? What do you sense? Okay. So in the first case, because the classroom or because the room is empty, the echoes of their sounds are heard. Now, remember, the distance between the students or the friends and the walls of the room is not 17 meters, right? But still, because the room is empty, right? What will happen? The sound will get reflected from the different walls repeatedly, okay, over and over again. Means there will be 4 walls, a ceiling, and a floor, right? So there will be 6 ways from which the sound waves can get reflected, right? And over repeated reflections, if the students or if the boys or your friends, if they are talking loudly enough, what will happen? The sound waves will experience multiple reflections, right? And what will happen? The sound will get echoed in the room. So after some time, it will become very difficult to hear one another because of these reverberations. Okay, let us look at the second case. Close the doors and windows of your house and switch on the music system, right? If you happen to have a music system or maybe a television, what you can do is switch it on, increase the loudness of the system as much as possible. You can put the music system on maximum volume or maybe the television and note what you observe. Okay. What happens for the second case is the sound of the music seems like jumbled and prolonged, right? What will happen is as the sound is loud enough in your room, the sound will get reflected from multiple surfaces and walls within your house. The reflections can also be taking place from the furniture that is in your home, right? So it becomes highly undesirable to listen to this sound after some time due to multiple reflections, right? So when sound happens to achieve multiple reflections and reach to the listener, it creates a very undesirable effect, right? And in this case, you are not able to hear the sound and it becomes very disturbing. Okay. And this concept is called as reverberation. Let us go into detail about what exactly is reverberation. Okay, now if you can look at the diagram here, you can see on the left hand side there is a person, right, who is the speaker or the source of the sound, and on the right hand side you can see a person sitting on a chair. Okay, so the sound waves can take different directions, right, because once a sound is generated, it travels in all the possible directions from the source of the sound. Okay, so in the first case, the sound can travel directly in the straight direction from the person, the speaker, to the listener. Also, the sound will get reflected. As you can see, there are various arrows showing the direction of the sound waves getting reflected. Now, once those sound waves are reflected, in each case, the reflected sound happens to travel a different distance. So, the reflected sounds will reach the observer or the listener at different time intervals. Right? So in that case, what will happen? The listener will get a continuous reflected sound. Okay, let us see what is reverberation. Now, sound waves get reflected from the walls and roof of a room multiple times. Repeated reflections of sound waves from the walls combine to build up what seems like a continuous sound. This causes a single sound to be heard not once, but continuously. This phenomena, or this is called as reverberation. So in reverberation, a single sound generated by the source, right, comes up to the listener as a continuous sound. Why? Because of multiple repeated reflections from the walls of the room or from the walls of wherever the person is sitting. And this phenomena is called reverberation. It is a very and highly undesirable property. Okay, certain auditoriums or certain public halls, even certain cinema halls happen to face such problems. If you have gone to a cinema hall, certain seats in a cinema hall are undesirable for watching the movie. Why? Because of such reflections. Okay, so there are various ways by which these continuous reflections and reverberation can be reduced. Okay, so let us see the further concepts. Okay, so the time between successive reflections of a particular sound wave reaching us becomes smaller, and the reflected sound get mixed up to produce a continuous sound of increasing loudness, which cannot be heard clearly. So if you can see, there is a person speaking on the stage. Okay, and there is a listener standing on the right hand side. Okay, so as the person is speaking, the direct sound reaches the listener first, right? But along with the direct sound, there are also sound waves which move in all possible directions from the speaker, right? So the reflected sound take multiple paths, right? And then they get reflected and reach the listener at different time intervals. Okay, so an enclosed room with many reflective surfaces can have such a problem. Okay, and if you happen to have a certain feature, if you happen to have certain object on the ceiling or on the wall, these objects can also behave as reflecting surfaces, right? So the time between successive reflections of a particular sound wave reaching us becomes smaller and smaller, and the reflected sound gets mixed up to produce a continuous sound of increasing loudness, which cannot be heard clearly, right? So it creates a lot of disturbance and the sounds cannot be heard distinctly. So whatever the speaker is speaking, the listener will not be able to listen carefully. Okay, then excessive reverberation is not desirable, as the speech of the speaker or the pitch of the music cannot be heard clearly due to the mixing of reflected waves and direct waves produced after the production of earlier waves. Yes, so after the direct sound reaches the listener, the reflected sound reaches the listener after a certain time interval, and due to which what happens is excessive reverberation is caused, which is not desirable. Okay, and whatever the speaker is speaking will not be able to be perceived by the listener. Okay, then let us talk about how reverberation can be reduced. Some auditoriums, public halls, or buildings are considered acoustically poor because of reverberation. Acoustics means sound waves, production and movement of sound waves. Okay, acoustics is the branch of science which deals with sound waves. Okay, so you can see some auditoriums or public halls or buildings are considered acoustically poor because of reverberation. Means they have lot of reflecting surfaces from which multiple sound reflection can take place. Okay, so to reduce reverberation, The roof and walls of auditoriums are generally covered with sound-absorbing materials such as compressed fiber boards, rough plaster, or curtains. Means you have to cover the walls of this auditorium with bad sound reflectors. That means they will not be reflecting the sound waves. Okay. Now, even the materials of the seats on which the people are sitting, they're very soft, right? And they are chosen in such a way that it absorbs the sound waves to the desired extent. So if you can look at this, right? On the top of the ceiling, you have these sound absorption panels, which have lots of holes in them, or they may be made with a material like a fiber board or maybe a soft material like foam. So it can absorb the sound and avoid the reflection of the sound. Okay, so to prevent the concept of reverberation, the roof and walls of auditoriums, right, they will have those long curtains. So if you may have visited a movie theater, the movie theater has a walls on either side which have large holes in them, right? So what happens is the sound enters those large holes and gets absorbed there. It does not get reflected. Okay, so all the people in the movie hall, they are able to enjoy the sounds in the movie. Okay, certain movie halls also happen to have soft, spongy walls, if you observe, right? And they may also have curtains to avoid the reflection of the sound. Okay, so the questions for this class are as follows. So I will expect students to be performing or to be solving those questions. Their definition of audible sound, then infrasound, ultrasound, echo, and reverberation. Okay, the next question is what? What must be the minimum distance be present between the source and the reflecting surface at 22 degrees Celsius to prevent to produce an echo? Okay, and this next question is state various methods to reduce the reverberation. Okay, so before we end the class, let us once again revise whatever we have done and studied today. Let us go through it once. Okay, so today we had seen the concept of the types of sound, right? Now the types of sound that we have studied today is based on the concept of frequency. Okay, so sounds are classified based on their differences in frequencies. So the three types of sounds are audible sound, infrasound, and ultrasound. Okay, then audible sounds have a frequency range from 20 hertz to 20,000 hertz. Then infrasounds have a frequency less than or lower than 20 hertz, and ultrasounds have a frequency higher than 20,000 hertz or 20 kilohertz. Okay, then the limits of hearing of the human ear are 20 hertz to 20,000 hertz, and human ear can hear the sound frequencies in this range, and these are known as your audible sounds. Okay, then infrasounds are the sound waves with frequency smaller than 20 hertz. They are called as infrasounds. These infrasounds are produced by objects which are oscillating less than 20 times a second, like a pendulum or maybe the vibrations of the earth's crust just before an earthquake. Okay, then ultrasounds are frequencies higher than 20,000 hertz, right? Certain animals like dogs, mouse, bats, they have this special ability to hear these ultrasonic sounds. Okay, then children under the age of 5 years and certain other animals and creatures can even listen sounds up to 25,000 hertz. Okay, then bats and mice along with dolphins can produce ultrasounds to communicate with each other and also to catch prey. Okay, then ultrasound are also used as a communication between ships at sea. It is also used in the ultrasonography machine, right, to have images of the internal organs of the body. It is also used to locate cracks and faults in metallic objects and tracks. Okay, then reflection of sound, we have studied reflection of sound also obeys the certain laws of reflection of light. That means the rays of incident ray happens to get reflected from a surface to give you a reflected ray, and the angle of incidence is equal to the angle of reflection. Okay, where all the incident ray as well as reflected ray and the normal, they lie in the same plane. Okay, then reflectors are classified as good reflectors and bad reflectors, right? So good reflectors can be having a hard and a smooth surface, right? Whereas bad reflectors happen to have a soft surface or maybe a spongy surface where they can absorb the sound. Okay, then echo we have studied, right? So an echo is the repetition of the original sound because of reflection from some surface. Okay, so in order to hear the original sound and its reflection at 22 degrees Celsius, right, the velocity of sound in air is 344 meter per second. Okay, our brain happens to retain any sound for a time period of 0.1 seconds. That means for us to able to hear a distinct echo, the sound should take more than 0.1 seconds after starting from the source to get reflected and come back to us. So we can calculate the minimum distance that must be present between the source of sound and the reflector to obtain an echo. Okay, so we can calculate that by using this formula, distance equal to speed multiplied by time. Okay, so here the speed of light, speed of sound is 344 meters per second, and the minimum time interval after which the sound has to come will be 0.1 seconds, right? So the minimum distance happens to be 34.4 meters back and forth direction. Okay, thus to be able to hear a distinct echo, the reflecting surface should be at a minimum distance of half of the above, that is at 17.2 meters. But you should remember that this distance of 17.2 meters can either increase or even decrease depending upon the temperature of the medium in which the sound waves are moving, because the velocity of sound waves is directly proportional to the square root of the temperature. Okay, so increasing temperature will increase the velocity of the sound. Okay, then we saw the concept of reverberation, right? So sound waves happen to get reflected from the walls and roof of a room multiple times. Okay, and repeated reflections of sound waves from walls combine to build up in what seems to be like a continuous sound, and this causes a single sound to be heard continuously, and such concept or such a thing is called as a reverberation. Okay, so the time between successive reflections of a particular sound wave reaching us becomes smaller and smaller, and the reflected sound get mixed up to produce a continuous sound of increasing loudness, which becomes very difficult to hear clearly. Okay, so excessive reverberation is not desirable, as the speech from the person or the sound produced by the source of the sound will not be heard clearly. Okay, because of the mixing of all of the reflective waves and direct waves produced. Okay, so some auditoriums, halls, concert halls, or even marriage halls, they happen to have acoustically poor building or acoustically poor structure because of the reverberation. So to reduce reverberation, the roof and walls the roof and walls of auditoriums are generally covered with sound absorbing materials such as compressed fiber boards or rough plaster or curtains, or maybe even a porous surface, okay, where the sound can be absorbed. Okay, even the materials of the chairs or the seats are selected in such a way that the sound can be absorbed. Okay, so these questions students need to be preparing. Okay, I expect students to be answering or answering the previous questions from the last class, right? So if you can go back to the meeting. Yes. Now, any student happens to have a question, any doubts here, please speak up. Yes, Neeraj Vishwakarma, go on. Yes, you can ask the question, Neeraj. Yes, any student has to ask a question, please speak out. Come on. Yes, Aryan Veta Bolo. Go on. Okay. Almas ma'am. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yes, madam. So we can conclude the class here for today. Students don't have